say it's done.
I'd say it's fine. Great. I'm Stephen Rhind-Tutt with ProQuest. This is my colleague, Carl Brown, from the University of Oklahoma. Before we kick off, I just got a couple of general questions here. So how many of you have actually been in virtual reality, as in put the glasses on? So most of you, okay. And how many of you are actually librarians? That's good. So I'm going to kick off here by talking about movies. And this is from about 100 years ago. And I thought I'd mention movies because 1910, 1920 was about the time when movies started to become really, really important. And if you take a look here, you can see that exactly what was going on in movies is happening in VR today. So there's a lot of entertainment going on. Underneath the surface, you started to have some really important scientific discoveries made. Muybridge's movies of horses. This is actually an analysis of a fly. And as you start to see the technology going from entertainment into education, scholarship, and research. And I think the same thing's happening today. If we take a look at how the library press is doing, there's an awful lot of mentions about virtual reality. But we need to be careful here because VR has got lots and lots of meanings. So I want to kind of nail down a little bit on definitions. So VR is actually, I think, a slightly confusing term. And if you read the literature, you'll find that there's a cluster of technologies really under the phrase extended reality. And I encourage you to use the term extended reality. In the journals I've read, it's gaining far more use than VR. Sadly, much like Sellotape and Hoover, there's a branding thing here, so a lot of people are calling VR what is in fact far, far broader. For those of you who aren't familiar, let's just wander through this spectrum here. So if we start off with the real world, augmented reality are those heads-up displays where we superimpose an object on the real world. So that's sort of kind of phase one. We start to get a little bit away from the real world and a little bit more into the invisibly written here, computer-generated world. Let's go then to mixed reality. So mixed reality has really been worked a lot by Microsoft, and there the digital objects actually interact with the world. So if you see on this diagram here, a real table, you can actually put the object behind the real table. And that gives you a lot more facility as to what you can actually do. And then finally, you have VR or virtual reality, and that's where you have the glasses on and you're entirely immersed in a world. Now, what's interesting about this to me is that if you actually take a look at the parallel again with movies, this is kind of a spectrum. So when you started off with movies, people must have been saying, what's this got to do with images? Well, actually, movies are simply moving images. And virtual reality, or extended reality in its broadest definition, is in fact the combination of 3D objects and scenes with some software to interact with, leading to immersion. And it's very dangerous for us to abstract just one of these things and say, oh, VR or extended reality is about full immersion. It's not. It's a far, far broader concept. So if you take a look at how it actually works, really what we've got is progressive experiences which get stronger and stronger as A, you spend more money, but also as you make the experience richer. And it starts with 360-degree videos. So YouTube already has over 1 million 360-degree videos on the YouTube website. It's very, very easy for people, if they have the right equipment, to get immersed in that. Then you go to 3D models and scenes, and those two are gaining acceptance. Then you have immersive worlds. Then you have interactive immersive worlds. And finally, you have collaborative worlds. So we're on this spectrum, and we're moving up gradually. And sadly, the more immersive the experience you want, the more expensive and difficult it is to do. And frankly, the standards get more and more confusing as you move up. In terms of hardware, there's an awful lot of hardware. It is settling down somewhat, but there's pretty much many different ways. And I want to point out here that there are two aspects which you may not have occurred to you are directly related to virtual reality. One is 3D printing, where you basically take an object that may or may not be part of virtual reality or extended reality, and you just print it out. For me, that's very, very similar to when you print out a PDF document. And indeed, those documents live in databases and they lend themselves to other experiences. The other thing is that many, many uses of VR occur in a 2D environment today. If you take somebody like Labster, that some of you may be familiar with, Labster is basically a virtual lab for a scientist to experiment virtually. The primary way that's used is actually on a 2D PC. So the question as to what actually constitutes VR is quite difficult to sort out. On the software side of things, there's many, many different programs that allow you to take 3D objects and put them into virtual reality scenarios. They include, of course, Autodesk for 3D models, for CAD/CAM, Unity and Unreal. Unity is probably the leading engine for actually creating VR environments. But there's also open source alternatives like Blender, and even really, really simple things. If you have MS Office, you'll start to see 3D objects appearing, getting us on that trajectory towards full VR. Let's take a look about when VR is needed. Now, some of you may be old enough to remember Second Life and how excited we all got about Second Life. And it really behoves us to ask, well, so is Second Life, you know, why didn't that work? What was it? Well, I think that with any technology, you've got to find the areas where it's really, really essential, not just nice to have. So the truth is, doing a lecture in Second Life, well, actually, it's kind of a worse experience than a video. Or creating a virtual campus in Second Life versus a video, it's kind of a worse experience. It doesn't actually help you much to be in virtual reality. Virtual reality is good in all these environments. You want to be messing around with plutonium, or you want to do that in VR? You want to understand a LiDAR image of Mayan ruins? Well, it's pretty hard to do that without actually being able to collapse the thing into a manageable space. What about molecules? Really complex carbohydrate chains? They're actually far too complex to represent in 2D. All of these areas is where VR is being used today, and in all of these cases, VR gives you something unique that really helps learning, that really helps scholarship, that really helps research. So I'm going to give you a couple more examples, and then I'm going to turn over to Carl about this. So let's start with some really interesting practical uses that you can take back to your library and say, this is really going on. So this is Rick Hunter and Stephen Tucker, and they basically go a camping slash hiking of a weekend just outside Johannesburg. And they went into this cave, which you can see in the bottom there, and they found some bones. And this was a really, really big deal. The bones they found were actually Homo naledi, and they were another step in the chain of how we understand how humans evolved. It got written up in some of the biggest papers. So what's interesting is, at the University of West Florida, they were able to print out those bones and actually experiment with them and actually use those bones and make them accessible to many, many different people. They were able to actually compare the bones virtually in 3D with other bones. And if you figure you've got a million-year-old object and you're trying to see if a particular tooth will actually fit into a particular jaw, that's not something you want to be doing with a real artifact. That's something where the value is immeasurable. In fact, it was only 12 hours after the original announcement of this that scientists around the world were actively able to interact with those bugs. That's a big practical example of how virtual reality and 3D models can help. In fact, Duke University has a website whose mission is, quote unquote, to take the bones out of museums and put them online. 10,000 3D models, a true repository of 3D models. That is a phenomenal addition to the scholarship. Another completely removed example. So in 2014, a number of humanities scholars in the University of Cyprus were really getting worried because these people here were disappearing in terms of people actually able to dance classical Greek dances are going away. Students today are far less interested in doing classical Greek dance than they are hip hop. And so as a result, people are like, wow, this is really interesting stuff. And this is not a small thing either. This represents over 2,000 years of culture. So what they did was they actually built a 3D digital archive of dance. They in fact got 3 million euros of funding to build this archive. And if you take a look, they've got points on everybody. So they're actually storing these dances in such a way that people can see very closely how they're performed. And indeed, at times in the future, insert said dance into virtual reality worlds. Completely different example again. Boston College, really interested in the study of James Joyce. They created a virtual world with 100 objects, 100 3D objects, that help explain Ulysses, this incredibly complex work, and actually enabled students to relate and see far more interaction and really understand Ulysses at a different level. Three very practical examples of how VR is helping. We did a survey of academic research libraries, and what was interesting about it was about 40% of academic research libraries had involvement with VR. Involvement was defined as they're collecting models, they've got a makerspace, they're lending out Rifts or Oculus machinery, or they actually have a real VR lab, about 40%. But what was most interesting is 100% of academic research libraries were actually, the institution at the departmental level was engaged in virtual reality. Every college I looked at had one or more VR initiatives. And they covered every subject under the sun. Some of them, it's really obvious, say medicine or engineering. No kidding. Really expect that. But let me find a good example. There is actually one for philosophy, measuring consciousness. I don't have it on this chart. That's really strange. I would have thought philosophy and virtual reality actually had a lot of overlap. But it does. And take a look. All of these aspects require VR and make use of those items I mentioned earlier. So, I'm going to wrap up. In my mind, the library has a huge amount to contribute here. These activities that you see listed are not happening at the departmental level. They simply are not. And as a result, you've got each individual department experimenting and making basic mistakes. I would give you more information about each of these departmental level things, but I can't find it on the web because the departments don't know how to share information. They don't make them publicly accessible, they don't detail, they're not discoverable. An example of where people are headed to me is at this university in Barcelona. And if you look at the mission statements, developing spaces of creativity, innovation, and generation of knowledge. VR belongs in that area. And if you don't, then the same thing is going to happen to 3D objects and virtual reality that happened with movies. You may not know this, all of the movies I'm showing you, the entertainment ones, including real film of Pancho Villa, have actually disappeared because nobody collected them. Libraries were not involved when they began. In fact, 86% of films in the States pre-29 disappeared. 86%, 50% of films pre-1950 have been lost. And all of this was because libraries did not feel that these were worth curating, collecting, managing at the time.
Go ahead and take
questions. Excellent. Any questions, thoughts? Just that good, huh?
So when you started off with extended reality, yeah. So you're not just talking virtual reality, you're including augmented reality?
That's a great question, by the way.
Viewed very separately.
I have spent such a long time trying to work out, okay, where does VR actually begin? Where does XR go? Where does AR go? And in truth, starting with 3D models, all the way on, right the way through to a fully immersive experience, I think that's all extended reality. And all part and parcel of the remit that we should follow. All right, Paul.
Thank you, sir. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about what we've done at the University of Oklahoma in this area. So I'm going to pick up on the question that Stephen was talking about. Why does it belong in the library? And I think one of the ways that I can give you a really powerful story about why it belongs in the library is a story that involves our medical school, a doctor at our medical school, and how he went and saw our lab, and then he went and took his child to see a Marvel movie, Strong Man, I believe it was, or whatever his name is. And that guy had a robotic hand in that movie. Well, he was working with a child and a parent, and the child was born with a palm but no fingers, just had little nubs of flesh. And so he saw that movie and he called us up after seeing our 3D lab and he said, can you guys print a hand like that? Well, the beauty of this story is the collaboration that's underneath it. And it could only really happen in a library, right? So we've got the 3D lab, we've got the 3D printers, we've got all this information we can access, we know about. So we get on the web and we start searching. And sure enough, there is somebody who's designed a hand that can be printed in 3D. And we take that plan and we modify it because we're dealing with a child that's 5 years old, very small on that. And so we started building a hand for that child. We sized it down and using 3D software and made it fit his hand. And so that's the hand that we printed for him. It's fully enabled, it will actually work. This is his hand. Now, for IRB reasons, I have to blank out parts of the scene, but you can see we put his hand in there. And that's it. But the money shot is this one. We sat that boy down, we put this hand on him, and for the first time ever, he could pick up his own hat with his own two hands and put it on his head. Now, to me, that is, you know, when I have a down day, that's a story I go back and review. I keep a copy of that hand in my office because it reminds me what we do in the library. We collaborate. We touch everybody in the university. We can pull expertise from everywhere, and we can join it together inside that library. We printed that hand for free. That child was very economically disadvantaged. Her parents couldn't afford an artificial limb, and we created that hand for that kid. And he walked out of our library a different young man than he did walking in. So if you want to ask, why do you do this in the library? Here's one of the most powerful examples I can think of. So what's our vision? You know, what are we doing with emerging tech? And I want to underscore something that Stephen said. This is really based on 3D technology. I think that's really important to understand. Sessions build virtual reality, and that's because that's what's of interest to everybody. But it's all based on 3D. And so we are always, in my shop, what we're doing is evaluating new and emerging technologies to see, does it advance the mission of the university in the areas of pedagogy and research? Does it do that? And if we can answer yes, if we see that a price point is getting to a place where we can afford it and make it available, and we start evaluating, and we start working with it. So, again, why the library? We have librarians. We connect people with information. We connect people with people. We have collections. We can pull resources in and help develop these things. We support the creation, interaction, distribution, and archiving, and information and knowledge in all its forms. I get so frustrated with librarians that are walking in and saying, but we're about books and journals. Well, yes, that's one way information is expressed, but it is not the only way information is expressed. It is now expressed in many different ways, and these are just new formats. And what's most important is that all those things Stephen was just talking about, those are just tools for interacting with those 3D objects. And there'll be new tools maybe tomorrow, maybe in a month from now, who knows? But we need to be aware of them, and we need to teach people how to use them. You'll see our branding at our university libraries, we're the intellectual crossroads. We're underscoring that idea that we connect with everybody on the campus. So why is it important? Well, because many small departments, they can't afford to do this. So the library becomes the test bed for the university. Try it out. Figure out, can we help the departments across the campus use it? You just saw Stephen show you in his survey, lots of different areas are using it. And it's certainly true at OU. We have no agendas, right? So a lot of times this technology goes into a department, maybe engineering, computer science, but it's really encased in their agenda. Whereas the library is, we want to help everybody. That's our job. We help lift the university. That's what we do. And so we make sure when we're working with these technologies, we're showing everybody what's possible. What can you do with this stuff? And we facilitate those collisions, those collaborations, and that interdisciplinary research. If you haven't read Leonardo da Vinci, the new Walter Isaacson book, read that one. It has a couple of wonderful quotes in it about why that man was so brilliant. And one of the reasons it's cited is because he was so cross-disciplinary, that he touched so many different fields. That's where some of his genius came from. Well, that's what we do in libraries. We do facilitate that all the time. And we do that with this kind of technology. So here's our lab. This used to be a 250 square foot break room for our students. But I love this room because it had windows that faced the main aisle of our library. And so I wanted people to be able to see these technologies. So we put our 3D printers right there. So they're in the windows and people go, you know, what is that? I want to know about that. You can see our 3D stations back here, which we custom built. We've got space for an HTC Vive back there. And then this is our work area. So 250 square feet is not a lot of space. And our total investment in that, about $10,000. So not a lot of money there. This is our law school. They like what we did so much that they put VR stations in their new collaborative learning commons at the law school. And you're thinking, law school, what are they doing with it? They're doing crime scene replication. So they take the testimony of a juror and they rebuild it in virtual reality. And it's kind of amazing, one of their favorite cases, one where they took the testimony, they went and photographed the spot where, you know, the crime theoretically occurred. They put the jurors in the headset, and you know what? You couldn't see the crime because there were bushes between where the crime occurred and where the person was standing. How'd you see through those bushes? No good answer. Case falls apart. They're doing all kinds of amazing work down in our law school with this stuff. Here's one of the things we've done to make it easier to use 3D. In our discovery system, when you do a search, when you do a search, get the right button, Carl, up here, we'll bring you back a bento box of results, and down at the bottom, we'll connect you with a 3D database. So we'll take the search you put in, and if you then click on it, click on this icon down here, we'll conduct the same search in a 3D database and find out, are there models right now that you can access that support or would be of interest to you in your research you're doing. And if there is, you can then push them directly to one of our VR stations. And when you walk into that lab where you just saw our stations, they'll be sitting there waiting for you. So it really makes it easy for people to use this technology. So why do we do this? Well, access. I think Stephen covered this pretty well. A lot of it is because it's fragile, it's destroyed. You know, it's already gone. It's distant, can't get to it, microscopic. Go in and see compound chemicals and walk through them. Students get amazed by that. And sociological relevant, there's lots of good reasons to do this. And of course, it gives you firsthand, unmediated learning experiences. So he was talking about, you know, skulls. We've done this with Mayan artifacts. You know, if you go down to our Sam Noble Museum of History, they're not going to let you pick up a Mayan artifact and handle it. But we've printed a 3D copy. You can handle that. In fact, we have some great stories to tell about that. So the lab fills up very quickly in our place, and you'll find lots of people in there all the time using these technologies. They're actively engaged with them. How do you get the faculty involved? That's a question I frequently get asked. How do you get the faculty engaged with VR? And I'll tell you, there's a sequencing to it. You start with your library team because you don't want them to be blindsided by somebody coming in and saying, hey, I want to use this stuff. Then you go to the provost, the deans. These are the people that have the higher vision usually. And they almost inevitably get it immediately. I have never put a dean in one of those headsets that they didn't stand up and say, I want this in my school, I want this in my courses, and I want it to happen soon. Okay, great. Then we work with the department chairs. Then we work with the department research liaisons. We get the new faculty because frequently they want to break, they want to have some kind of breakthrough in research. So they're a good possibility. Then we go and we have faculty on our campus that every year there's awards handed out because they, by their peers, are nominated because they are doing leading edge work. Good targets because they want to stay on the front edge. We talk to them every year. Donors love it. I had a donor that we put in a headset and got up and wrote us $1 million estate grant to fund purely innovation. Now, of course, I got to wait till they pass away. But, you know, down the road, somebody's going to get a nice check. And so I'm actually meeting them Friday again. Students, of course, jump at this technology, getting them involved. Then you go to the college department meetings. And the people you talked to last are regular faculty. You have to surround them with people going, have you been over to the library and seen that new thing you're doing VR? And then they finally show up at your desk and go, everybody's telling me you got this new thing called virtual reality. Show it to me. So when you surround them, you can get them there. Here's another way we get them involved. We have them run what we call portal sessions. So we run sessions where we invite an expert in to narrate a session where we are showing something that you can't normally see. So we've done Arizona Arcade Caves. I'll show you that in a minute. We did the Syrian ruins at Palmyra. You know, those were knocked down, destroyed. But we were able to rebuild them in virtual reality. And so we have people that can give tours and show them what no longer exists. We've done the same thing with live sea turtles recently, which is, that's a really fascinating tour. You probably wouldn't think so, but I promise you, it is an amazing experience to go through it. These events are really book-sized. They're big. They're asynchronous, you know. Multi-platform, we can run them on many different platforms. You always want to design multiple platforms. And they feature, you know, what I said, we bring in an expert, we can connect people on the web. Doesn't even have to be near it. In fact, here's a great story. In September 2017, we held, at least as far as we can find, for the first time ever, we had a virtual reality class held in higher ed across 7 remote locations. 2 in Arizona, 5 in Oklahoma, with 15 total people in the class, with an instructor who was an expert in arcade caves giving a tour of a cave that was on private property. But that person was willing to let us take pictures of the inside of the cave so we could build it in virtual reality and then give tours. He didn't want people on his property, not going to open it up for the public, but he was willing to let us take enough pictures to build it in virtual reality and give tours that way. So here's something you can't access any other way, but we were able to do it, and we were able to do it across the web. And so people all over, and we could bring in an expert who was in Arizona, not in Oklahoma, in order to do that. Pretty powerful. Here's something we're doing right now. We have an architecture exhibit in our main aisle of our library. So we've worked with colleges across the campus frequently when we're doing exhibits. And so the College of Architecture happens to be the home of Bruce Goff and the American School of Architecture. He was a contemporary of Frank Lloyd Wright. Amazing architecture. And so we put together this exhibit, and you'll notice a 3D model. You can't see the fine detail here, but this is called the Babinger House. One of the most amazing pieces of architecture this gentleman did was Wright and Norman. And it fell into ownership issues and fell into disrepair. In 2011, it was destroyed by a weather event. Well, that's a huge loss, because it's a beautiful, beautiful architecture, piece of architecture. That was the design. That's the actual house before it got knocked down. And this was the inside of it. If you walk in that library and you go down the main aisle and you take the tour, at the end, on the right, is that innovation at the edge space, that 250 square feet. If you go in there, you can sit down in our headset and you can take a virtual reality tour of this home. You can hear the water flowing through this home. You see the water, the stream over here? There's water flowing through the house. You can hear that. You can turn in any direction. It is like walking in that house. We have rebuilt that piece of architecture. I'm gone for 7-8 years now. And you can experience it again today in virtual reality. We've done that with other architecture of his that never got built in order to help people understand what was so amazing about this man and his architecture. We've done this in the humanities with medieval transcripts. This gentleman went and photographed with Chad Gospels. He took 70 photographs of each page, different filters, but in order to build these pages, because what he wants to do is rebuild these pages to their original color and spec in order to restore what they would have been like, what you would have experienced. And then virtual reality, you can tour over that page literally in micrometers over the page to figure out what ink is flaked off, what ink is still there. Is there enough ink left in the fiber to figure out what the color was? He is rebuilding these pages in virtual reality to their original specifications. The only way he could do this is in virtual reality. And it's pretty amazing. So he's done all the imaging. He's done the close-up transcription of them. And he's even printed out 3D copies of pages so that people can feel them and understand what has flaked off and what's still there. He took that to a conference and he became an instant hit in the conference because he could do that and show that to people. So it's pretty amazing. It's also got all kinds of community outreach. So we work a lot with our local public schools to say, we can help you bring this into the high schools and help them understand the value of it. And I thought this was a wonderful quote from one of our teachers who said, by far, the most amazing opportunity I've ever had with these kids in the 4 years I've been doing this job. Because the kids were just so engrossed in it. They were so amazed by what they were seeing and learning. It was a very powerful moment. Okay, some impact. Some metrics. So in 2017, of course, we're in like the first quarter of 2018, or getting close to the end of the second quarter, I guess, but we had 3,200 unique VR sessions across multiple locations at OU. 3,200. We have 20 courses where the kids have to come into the VR labs to do homework in virtual reality. That is part of their learning experience. Those deans were serious when they said, I want this in my college. I want my kids to know how to use this. 500 students have required course assignments in 2017. And the response we get is, it's inspiring, it's eye-opening, learning objectives achieved. We've held 100 intro-type VR workshops in 2017. We're at 110 so far in, the first two-thirds of this year. 110 so far. And we have representation. We have 11 of the 13 colleges. These buttons are too close together. In 11 of the 13 colleges, we have at least one course being taught using VR. And we have the last two scheduled to come on before the end of this academic year. So far, we've secured $95,000 in grant money in 2017 for VR work. And we've got another $300,000 grant under development right now. I guess the point to make is this isn't something futuristic, folks. This is today. This is happening right now. All right. Where are we going in the future? Okay, well, It's still in its infancy, there's no question. You know, lots of things to be done. The headsets can still be kind of clunky. There's cabling involved in many instances. Be costly, it's not cheap. But it's clear where we're going. We're moving towards headsets like this. This is an Apple's idea of what this is gonna end up being something like. And we clearly have a need for metadata to go around these objects, because they're very hard to find. The best, you know, they're just very short descriptions. We need rich metadata so that we can interlink these things, we can bring them together and build a more rich experience. And then we're gonna need to get repositories built for that to happen. We've got some disjointed instances going on. Most campuses, they have some number. You know, I think we have several thousand in our repository. But we need to get a much larger repository and support for the metadata that goes around this. So those are things I'm expecting we'll see in the near future. And so that's what's happening at OU in 3D and virtual reality. So I think we have 10 minutes for questions. We actually ended on time, Stephen. So questions. Yes, sir.
Thank you, by the way. Thank you for that presentation. So I noticed, you know, you talked about we're doing this, and you talked about the cost. A lot of this stuff is expensive. How do libraries that don't have a lot of money, don't have all this research, how do we get involved? Or is this going to be one of those things, hey, the technology caught up the way, say, smartphones caught up, and now everyone has one. Is it just going to be dumped on libraries and be like, hey, VR is a thing, and go buy it for $9.99 and throw it in your library?
Yeah, I think we will get there eventually, but that's really not the answer to your question. The answer to your question is, using the Unity operating system, that's free, because we're educational institutions, so you just sign up for that. The Oculus headsets now, while we spent, $1,000 for one of those headsets. Now for about $200 you can buy an Oculus Go, which isn't quite functionally as rich, but it has no cabling, you don't have to have a huge computer, you can put it on your head and you can work. So you can do virtual reality right now. I think the bigger question is, you can't just put this stuff in a room and say, have at. You have got to put a staff person there who's interested in it, and it's gonna take and drive it forward, because one of the things I'm convinced that has led to our success at OU is that I've had some really remarkable young people that get very enthusiastic about this, and they see ways to help instructors and researchers utilize the technology. As Stephen said, you've got to find the right fit, but these folks have figured out where that is, and so they can sit down with people and do an analysis of their project and say, this wouldn't help you, or this would, and then build off of that, because when you get people to start using it, you want to get people that are going to be wildly successful with it, like our medieval manuscripts gentleman. That guy, he will come in and talk about what he wants to do with the next thing. He will do a dance on the floor. He's getting so excited about the ideas. And he goes out and he tells everybody about it. That's what you want. You know, you've got to fit in those people on your campus. And you've got to make sure they're successful. So you've really got to assign somebody to work with them and figure out what are the glitches, what are the problems, how do we overcome them. If you do that, you can get started, and you don't have to have a big space like that. You can just have a designated spot. With these Oculus Go's, you can sit in a chair and you can use them. You need a little space to move your hands with, because there's some hand tracking involved. And you don't want them snapping the person next to them, right? So you gotta make sure there's a little space, but that's not hard. We all have that problem. So you can get started quite affordably. I think what we're showing you is what's possible in hopes that it inspires you to get started. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the people who helped get this going in your library, and what do you think? You said they're enthusiastic, but can you talk a little bit more about their background and the kinds of support that you might have had to provide to enable it to go?
Absolutely. I will tell you that my superstar in my VR lab, I found at the circulation desk. He was a library school student. We got a library school on campus. And he was working, and he's just very fascinated by technology. He started in a totally different area of technology, but once we brought him in, we were doing Galileo's work, an exhibition, and we wanted to use virtual reality to show the world that Galileo, the solar system, the way Galileo thought it existed, as compared to the tapes we got from NASA, which show what really is out there. And so we went and saw, at Arkansas, their lab, which is a huge room, a cave, for doing virtual reality. And at that time, the technology was announced from Oculus. And so we lined up and bought some Oculus Rift headsets, brought it in. I took this young man who's curious, he's trained in philosophy. His degree is in philosophy. But he's curious, he's a real go-getter, and you turn one like that loose. Now, you gotta give him guidance, sure. But I love mentoring young people. So, you know, if you've got somebody that's a good mentor and we'll take them under wing, and I've got a technology background so I could guide him. And, you know, he's gone on to win national awards for the work he's done. I'm very proud of that. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Sorry, I have another question.
That's okay.
And I'm really interested in AR, VR, extended art. So, it's for ProQuest. So how is our vendors like helping us? Or so what's the vision there? Because he's doing great work. Not that you don't do great work. Everyone does great work. But how is that going to support us or get this whole like VR into mainstream?
So let's start off with 360-degree videos. Academic video online product. Well, it may actually be very close. I think it was due either this month or next month to have full 360-degree videos. And I want to once again just reiterate, try and think of this as a spectrum rather than as a destination. So what I mean by that is with your mobile phone and a 12 buck Google cardboard, you can get something of a VR experience with these 360-degree videos. That's all it takes. But that's just for starters, that's small. Step by step by step, now if you've got more money, you can get an Oculus Go. Okay, that's cool, that will give you, but it won't allow you fully to interact because the Oculus Go knows far less about where you are in space. And then you can do the Rift. So, in answer to your question, 360-degree videos, and Andrew, I don't know if you want to stand up. Andrew and I are actually really interested in engaging with you about how we can take things forward. I am a huge believer in this technology. It's kind of funny to see you all here. Some of you may know I am one of the founders of Alexander Street Press. And here in Charleston in 2007, I did a presentation on video. And streaming video in particular. And actually, we got fewer people in the room than are here today. It takes a while for people to realize it, but today streaming video is standard across libraries. And those libraries which chose not to embrace streaming video are serving their students less well, they're serving their faculty less well. So the short answer is 360-degree videos today. And we'd love to engage with you to see what we can co-create going forward.
Yeah, I'd just like to add, please feel free to give me your card. I'd love to talk to you afterwards. I'm always interested.
Other questions? We've got 2 minutes. Or actually, no, we don't. Don't we end at 10 after? Is this at 10 after or 15?
10 after.
10 after, we're done.
Okay. Thank you so much.